test, and the Word sends out 360 teams. 360? That. A lot of teams, there are a lot of teams, and they are the team which is going to be sent out. So there's one team for a biology contest, and they're going to talk about biofilters for cow stables tonight. So please give a warm welcome for the next two presenters.
All right.
Can you hear me? Yes? Okay.
Yes.
Can we start? Yes? Okay. My name is Jenny and this is Riemer, and we are part of Catalyst. We are building a biofilter that will convert both methane and ammonia emissions from cattle farms into less toxic compounds. So we all know that methane contributes to global warming, and ammonia emissions have a very serious environmental impact. So it's one of the causes of the nitrogen crisis, and a lot of measures have already been taken, so that's why we can only drive 100 kilometers per hour on highway now, and also the farmers have to reduce the livestock sector. We have a solution for this problem, that's making a biofilter. This biofilter will contain microbes that convert both methane and ammonia. And these microbes will be genetically modified organisms, also known as GMOs. We see an overview of a filter here on the left. So on the bottom, the ammonia and the methane will come in, and then our microbes will basically eat the methane and ammonia, and thereby they release the clean air. We are working with GMOs, and today we're here to talk to you about how we're going to make sure that these GMOs will not escape and that our solution to the problem is safe for both the environment and for humans.
So thank you, Jenny. So I will just briefly explain what precisely is a GMO. So quite simply, I'll make an analogy to cooking, and let's see the biological cell as a cook. And cooks, of course, need cake to live. I think this is rather obvious. And you can look at the DNA basically as the recipe book of, basically our cook. And when we look and talk about genetically modified organisms, there are basically two categories to take into account. So the first category that I'll just briefly explain. The first category is the loss of function category. Here we have the organism and we take something out of its recipe book. So basically we take the book, we just rip a bunch of pages out. So suddenly, instead of being able to make tarts, muffins, and brownies, it is no longer able to make muffins. This is generally regarded as not very dangerous because you just basically you cripple an organism, and when it is released into the environment, there's not really any very direct dangers. However, the second category is the gain of function. So here we have our microorganism, or we have our cook, and we just stick a bunch more pages in its recipe book. So suddenly it's also able to make baklava. This has some more harmful consequences because we cannot really predict what will happen if this microorganism is released into the environment. And therefore, it is very important to be cautious about what you're doing with it. It is for this reason that biofilter will use these GMOs with a gain of function, so they are better equipped to, again, consume the methane and ammonia and convert it into non-harmful gases. But then we are, of course, working with genetically modified organisms which have a gain of function. And therefore, it's very important to be precautious about what might happen. And therefore, we have a few measures to ensure biocontainment so that we are sure that our genetically modified organism does not ever leave our biofilter.
Okay, so the first measure that we have is that we make the two microorganisms dependent on each other. So we come back to our example of the cook that needs a cake. We have now one cook that only has a lot of eggs but does not have any flour, and therefore it cannot make a cake. But the neighbor has the exact opposite problem. It has a ton of flour, but it does not have any eggs. So the cook can go to his neighbor and they can exchange ingredients, and together they can make a nice cake and they can survive. In our biofilter, we will let the microorganisms exchange compounds so they are dependent on each other. In case one of the two escapes from our filter, they will no longer have the eggs, for instance, to make the cake, so they will die. And that's one of the measures to prevent them from escaping, because they can only make the cake together. Then we have the second measure. The second measure is sort of similar, but in this case, every microorganism or every cook has just a little bit of sugar, and that amount of sugar is not enough to make a cake. But if they all come together and are very close, they can share the amount of sugar they have and they can make a cake together. And in this case, if one would escape, it would produce a little bit of sugar, but that would not be enough to make the full cake. So also, in this case, they can only make the cake together. If they escape from the filter, they will die because they cannot make the cake again. And for our filter, they will also make a small compound. They will exchange it with each other and therefore be able to survive. Then we have our third measure. Third measure is a little bit more complicated, maybe, because normally they just make a cake, but in this case, they make brownies. But these brownies, they are toxic, as well, we made them toxic. So there is a recipe in this book that's broken. And in our biofilter, we provide the antitoxin. So the microorganisms in our filter will not die. When they escape from the filter, there is no antitoxin anymore. So in that case, they will die. In our case, in our biofilter, the methane that is there that they have to convert, that's our antitoxin. And outside of the biofilter, the methane concentration is lower. And therefore, they cannot survive outside of the biofilter. So that's the third measure that we take to prevent escape from the of these microorganisms into the nature.
Yeah, precisely. So it's very important to ensure containment of GMOs. And just to kind of wrap it all together, so our first measure, as you can see here, is what we call an auxotrophy. They are feeding off of each other. Our second aspect is called a quorum sensing, where they sense if the compound, or in our case, the sugar, is actually present, and if it is not present, they will die. And again, they cannot make enough of this compound alone to not trigger the mechanism. So the moment they are alone or they have escaped, they do not produce enough and therefore they die. And our first method is the toxic brownies or the poisonous brownies, where we provide an antitoxin for the toxic brownies they make themselves. And this will hopefully ensure biocontainment. But it's very important to consistently stay critical, because it is something of which we do not know the outcome, if hence it be released in the environment. So if there's any questions, feel free to ask them. And you can scan the QR code to find us on Instagram, or you can find us on Instagram at igem.wageningen. And thank you for listening.
For the Q&A session, and then maybe there are any participant will add to us. Okay.
Thanks for the very nice presentation. Yeah. It's a really clever and nice idea. But the public opinion in Europe particularly is really against GMOs. But what would happen if one of these GMOs would become viable and would escape to the environment? Would that be so bad?
So, I need to prevent it. That's pretty important. What he's asking is what happens if they do escape. Most likely it will just die, right? It is not actually fitted to live outside of the biofilter just because of what it eats. it is exclusively feeding on ammonia and methane in such concentrations as you do not find anywhere outside of this biofilter. However, it is so important to make sure that they just don't, right? And the public opinion in Europe is pretty much completely opposed to gain of function GMOs, but they have great potential, and that is something we really should harp or at least explore, for example, for the nitrogen crisis.
Okay, thank you for the question. Really nice question. And then the next, maybe from a participant on the top? No? Okay, and then.
Well, we now have basically a design of the cow sheds where we collect the breath of the cows and we collect the air that comes from the pit that's like below the barn where all the manure is stored. And we combine these two airflows into the biofilter. So that's why we have a relatively high methane and ammonia concentration in a biofilter. And then outside of the stable or, well, depends on how the stable looks, of course, we will try to fit the biofilter.
Okay. Is that clear? Anybody will ask in? Yeah, come on.
Yeah, looking from the farmer's perspective, like, of course, they need to invest money into this system. But what can we get in return for that?
Yeah, that's a very, very important question to ask. I think I can partly answer that by saying that they, at the moment, there's strict regulations saying that need to decrease the emissions of ammonia and nitrous oxide or NOx gas derivatives. And by using this biofilter, they can show to the government, we are doing this, and hopefully they will get subsidized to use the biofilter, because there is no lucrative value that is created by a biofilter, except maybe clean air, which is something that we should value very strongly, in my opinion.
Yeah, inside of the biofilter, inside of the stable, the ammonia concentration is also, of course, a bit higher, which gives not a super nice air inside of the filter. So in that regard, also the farmers benefit from it, because if you have cleaner air inside of the stable, because you collect the air from the pit, the overall climate in the stable also improves. So that's both nice for, well, the farmer, but also for the cows, because the atmosphere in which the cows are living all the time improves.
Yeah. Thank you for the question. Okay. Again, question?
Technical, maybe a bit nasty question. Mm-hmm. Is the gain of function mutations, are they on the genomic DNA or on plasmid DNA?
Plasmids.
Depends on... yeah, what we're basically doing. Like, the nicest thing is to have it on genomic DNA, because plasmids, they can lose. But because it's for us easier to insert a plasmid to see if it works overall, we of course start with plasmids. But in case we get further, we try to put it in the genomic DNA as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, is that enough with the third question? If anybody will ask it? Okay, good. Okay.
Anybody, maybe the presenter who asked it, can summarize, then they can hear the question.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So.
Yeah, I don't know if I need to summarize the last question.
Just in general.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks.
You want it or
no? No, I don't think I have anything.
Okay, so I think it's enough. So the question is about the biofilter system, and this is the very interesting topic that we discussed today. And somebody asked about the public opinion in the Europe, and then the others asked about the other interesting question. And then maybe if there is no other question again for this discussion, maybe we can continue with a break, or there is some energy issue again. Oh no! Oh, okay. Maybe we can continue with the break.
Thank you.
Okay.
your chair around if you're online watching. So the next presentation is also going to be a very interesting one. I tried to ask him, what are you? But I cannot pronounce that word, so therefore I will call him an insect scientist. There is a better word for it, but please don't ask. And he's a PhD student. So tonight, Luc Roijmans will present how he can make agriculture more friendly for insects. So I would say give it up, please, for our next presenter, Luc Roijmans.
Yeah, well, hello, thank you. I hope I'm understandable, I think. So indeed, I'm an entomologist. That's the difficult word that we're looking for. It's a shame that we always have to go to this sort of Latin names, because I think insect sciences for me is way more clear than all these names. Today I'm going to tell you why I think that a good neighbor is actually better than having a toxic friend. And where this sort of hinges onto is this idea, or these papers that have come out, that you see that the insect populations are really declining. So there's been a study in 2017, which became really big news, because there they said that 75% of insect biomass has declined over the last 30 years. So that's sort of where this hinges into. And today I kind of want to tell you a little bit what that means for us, but also, of course, why we should be bothered by that, because I kind of want to show you also the beauty of all these insects and all these things that are normally sort of hidden from sight, maybe by you. And of course, I want to end also with a bit of a positive note, so bear with me. We might go maybe in a bit of ups and downs, but I try to end always a bit positive. There's tons of functions that insects do. There's loads of insect species only in the Netherlands, let alone in the whole world. And they serve a lot of different functions. And I think one that strikes the most for people is pollination. And pollination is sort of the act of, well, in this case, insects going to a plant, taking the pollen, and then bringing it to another plant, and that way fertilizing these plants. And there's a lot of different ones. So we have this nice rose beetle here, which I think is really pretty, or this wasp that is actually a beetle, or this bumblebee and bee that are actually not bee and bumblebee, but actually flies. But I just wanted to fool you there a little bit. There are these beautiful, I think in English they're called mirror-winged flies. I think in Dutch they're called prachtvliegen. I think these are so beautiful, but always underlooked, because people always think when they look at it quickly, see, oh, it's a fly, oh, it's a fly. But then if you look closely, you see like these beautiful wing patterns on there as well. And I think one of the most beautiful insect species of the Netherlands is actually also a pollinator. And that's this dagbouw oog, which I actually don't know what the English name is. I completely forgot. I can tell you the Latin name, but that won't really do you that much good, I think. But it's this beautiful butterfly, and it also actually, the caterpillars eat nettles, which I think we don't really like most of the time, so they're even quite useful in that sense as well. Then they serve also a purpose in soil health. There's a lot of insects that eat harmful fungi in the ground. They might decompose plant materials like these worms do. Well, worms actually not an insect, maybe you might say, but I'll just include them here as well. There's actually a bunch here that are not really insects, but I took the liberty to include them as well. Then they also serve like a big role in the food chain, or the food web that we have. So often these insects are actually important food sources for, let's say, for example, these farmland birds that you see here, or this spitzmuis, shrew in English. And actually, insects are really important. We might sometimes think that a lot of these birds, well, they can also live off seeds or these things, but actually the young, when they're growing up, they really need these proteins from the insects to grow up. So without these insects, they can't really hatch. And then I think the function that I want to put most emphasis on today is their role as natural enemies. So a lot of insects actually might be harmful to crops that we grow, or might do some things that we don't like, but there's also a bunch of insects that actually try to sort of help us out. So here's some examples of that. So you can see here, this surferfly larva. So it's also this hoverfly that I showed before, that I said, oh, it's a bee or a bumblebee. No, it's actually not a bee or bumblebee. It's a hoverfly, and their larvae actually eat aphids. There is these beetle species that eat a lot of insects that can be harmful. And so you have a ton of different species that help us out there. And to give you an example, I actually want to show you a little video. So I hope that's going right in the stream. It might be a bit difficult. I'm so sorry if it doesn't go right. Just send me a message if it doesn't. Then I'll show it to you again. And I'll tell you, I have to warn you a little bit in advance, it's a bit gruesome. You might have seen these videos of lions hunting zebras or whatever, but insects do it like top notch. I think if you want to go to a horror movie, they can really show it. So be warned in that sense. If you're a bit sensitive to this footage, then it might be a bit rough. So here we go. So here we see, I don't know, how can I start this up? Well, then you'll just get it later, I think. I can maybe send it to you, and then you can send it around. Is there a space bar? No. Well, whatever. So the thing is, you see a little beetle here, and I was going to put a caterpillar in front of it, and then you could see how it actually hunts its caterpillars. I think it's beautiful footage, but it's in the eye of the beholder maybe also a little bit. Well, so what I actually want to talk a little bit about is also this decline that we were talking about. And one of the main reasons of this insect decline, or actually two of the main reasons, one of them being these homogeneous landscapes that we often see. And homogeneous landscapes mean that the landscapes are really sort of similar on big parcels. So what we see a lot in the Netherlands, especially if you go, for example, to Flevoland, you see a lot of these really big fields of just one crop. And there's nothing really else growing there. And this means that actually for some insects, it's really useful, right? If you just eat this crop, if that is your main food source, then that's actually useful. It's like, I actually call it a little bit living in a desert made of cheese. And if you like cheese and if you can live only on cheese, then you're in paradise. But if you're lactose intolerant, you're not gonna fare well there. So that's a bit of an issue here. And another issue is that actually in these landscapes, as I said, if you're one of those species that likes cheese, you're actually going to thrive well there. But if you actually want to harvest this cheese in the end to sell, then you're going to have an issue with these insects that actually are taking away your source of income. And then for that reason, a lot of pesticides are actually used. And that's sort of the second issue that comes about. And these pesticides often also target non-target insects. So why is this actually that you see in these homogeneous landscapes that there's not that many insects? Well, one of the main reasons is that a lot of insects actually need a lot of different resources to really grow, develop, to complete their life cycle. And that's what I tried to illustrate here. So here you see the life cycle of this hoverfly that I talked before about. And the life cycle of a hoverfly, like so many insects, starts as an egg, which you can see here at the bottom, at the left. And an egg needs, well, in broad sense, two things, right? It needs time because it needs to develop into a larvae, but it also needs the right climatic conditions as well in the meantime. Then it grows into a larvae, then it needs other things. Well, it needs prey, it needs to eat, it needs maybe also to overwinter in these surface fly or these hoverfly cases. They overwinter as larvae, so they need to be able to find some place to overwinter. Then they become a pupa, they need sort of the same prerequisites as when near an egg. And then eventually become an adult, and then they need flowers for pollination, and they need to find mates as well. So there's a lot of different things that they need, and then they can't find all these things in this homogeneous landscape that I just showed you. But then we have offered a lot of different solutions to this already. So things that have been tried already is, for example, these flower strips. Well, you can imagine this flower strip can offer actually sort of the resource, one of the resources for this hoverfly, as an example. It can be, can they use these flowers, or if these flowers stand there for several years in a row, then they can actually use this overwinter places as well. You have these hedgerows, which also serve sort of another function. You can have these waterways in between fields. Some insects really need to grow in the water at some stage, and then they go onto the land. And if famous example of that is dragonflies, which are actually really great hunters in the air. So they need these different things. But what all these things also mean is they mean a sort of giving up certain land that you could otherwise also use, right? So if we then go to the perspective of a farmer, he might think, well, it's all nice and good that I want to put flower strips here or waterways here or all these different things, but that will all come to a cost of land, which is a bit of a disadvantage there. But actually, there is also a solution a little bit for that. And that solution holds in this concept that's called intercropping. And the idea of intercropping is maybe a difficult word, but it just simply means growing two or more crops close together. That's it. And a really old example of that is the Three Sisters system. Maybe some of you heard of it, maybe not. But it's a system that actually Native Americans already used back in the day. And it consists of sort of three crops that grow together. So they have the first thing that they grow is corn or maize. This grows quite tall. Then they grow beans underneath it. These beans actually grow into this corn. And they can actually use the corn as sort of a holdfast. And the beans actually serve the corn with nitrogen, because these beans can take up nitrogen from the air, put it in the soil, and then the soil actually becomes more fertile. And the last one you can see in the bottom is pumpkin or squash. And that's actually used as a sort of soil cover. It has several functions. They plant that as last, as the last thing. And it retains water, for example, because it creates this nice shading on the soil. But it also serves actually a funny function as a resistance against raccoons, because apparently raccoons don't really like the hairs that are on pumpkin plants. So they try to actually avoid this as well. So that's his double function. Well, then you might think, well, that's a nice example, Luke. Thank you for that. But as a farmer, I can't really see this happening on a big scale. I'm going to quickly skip this slide because it doesn't fit in my story anymore. But then I would say, well, it can actually fit. And the way that it can fit is with strip cropping. And that's actually what I'm sort of studying at the moment. So the idea of strip cropping is also a form of intercropping, because we grow crops close to each other. And strip cropping is simply the growing of crops in strips next to each other. And these strips can be indefinite long. It doesn't really matter how long they are. But the crux is that they're only like a certain width. And the smaller, the narrower they are, at least for the plant interactions, the plant interaction becomes stronger. So certain plants interact in a positive way. It could also be in a negative way. As I said, with this, for example, this Three Sister system, these beans and these corn work together. So if they're close together, these positive interactions are also stronger. If the interactions are negative, of course, these negative interactions are also stronger. So that's also something to keep into account. But why this is nice also for the insects is that now all of a sudden you create a landscape where there's a lot of diversity in the field, and there's a lot of different functions. And these crops might grow in different stages of the year. They might serve, some crops might grow flowers, some might not, some might be there for a couple of years. So you can just imagine that it just creates this diversity in the field as well. And we actually, from our own research, we actually saw that it actually does happen. So there's this research of Bernard, who you can see in the bottom. And he actually found that there are more ground beetle species, but also just a high abundance overall. So just a total number that you find in smaller strips. So the smaller the strips are, the more beetles you find. That's a good thing, I would say. And then sort of the opposite story of that. So if we go back to this monoculture, you actually see that we saw that these monocultures, the bigger the monoculture is, sort of the stronger the pest pressure is. And that's actually what you can see here on this dark purple bar. So this dark purple bar is the abundance of a certain cabbage moth, which eats cabbages and which is actually a bit of a pest insect. And you can see that here, there's a lot of them. This is the biggest monoculture. Then we go to a bit of a smaller monoculture. You already see a bit less, but it's still quite high. And then if we do strip cropping, you see that it just drops down. So they don't completely disappear. You will always have a little bit, but yeah, a little bit is also maybe not too bad, actually. Another funky thing is that what you can see is that it's also more diverse, actually. So there's even a higher diversity of pests, which is actually maybe nice, because maybe this one predator actually doesn't eat this pest, but it might eat this other pest. And then you can create also just a high diversity in the field that can help in the end as well. Yeah, and then I also wanted to it's a bit of a difficult graph, and the next one I'm going to show you is even more difficult, but I really wanted to show you this because it links well with the thing that I was talking about before with, for example, these hedgerows, these flower strips, and these kind of things. So this is from a research where they looked at the abundance, also I think it was of ground beetles, in sort of the center of a monoculture, and on the edges where you have, for example, flower strip or something else, right? And then what you see is in these edges, you see a lot of ground beetles, and then in the middle, you don't really see a lot of them anymore. So they actually, the closer you get in the center of this monoculture, the worse these effects of these flower strips or things work. So they work really well at the edges, but the further you go inwards, the less well they work. And then, as I said, the more difficult one, it's a horrible graph. The colors will change around, so that's a bit difficult, but I'll try to work it through. So you can see here at the bottom, the purple and the blue lines, they actually indicate the ones that I just showed you with the edge in the middle. And what the nice thing is that you can show here with the see here with the red and the green lines, which are two types of strip cropping, is that they actually work a little bit the same as these edges. So all of a sudden, you're creating these edges in the field, but then all over the field, because you have these strips throughout the field. So this effect that you had on these edges from the flower strips, you're now taking into the field without offering up land as flower strips. Because as I said, we're not doing flower strips here, but we're growing two crops, right? So the farmer is happy because he can still grow two crops, and the insects are happy because they can benefit from this higher diversity here, closer together. I'm quickly going to skip this one. I think it was maybe a bit too much. Yeah, this one I wanted to show as well, because as I said at the start, these insects are actually part of this bigger food web or this food chain. And what we also see is that if you, it was also from our research from Chris, and what he actually found is that if you have smaller parcels, so smaller plots of land, then you see a higher biodiversity in birds. So we actually expect that with strip cropping, we might also be able to increase this this diversity and maybe also abundance of farmland birds, which might be driven partly because of new shelters for these birds, but also because there's more insects, which might be a food source again for these birds. That's where that also hinges in. Well, then I think the last thing that I wanted to talk about, I told you I wanted to end in a really positive note. I actually think I didn't go really negative anyway, but I still want to add in a positive note. And it's from my own research. So last year, we found this species of ground beetle on the fields where we do research here in Wageningen. It's called Haupelus signaticornis. In Dutch, it's called Kaalkopkruiper. In Dutch, in English, it doesn't really have a name. It's really sad. So if you have a good name, maybe you can send it to some taxonomist and then they might name it. Who knows? But this Kaalkopkruiper, this Haupelus, actually was really rare in the Netherlands. And you didn't really see it a lot anymore. I'm not sure if it was almost extinct worldwide, but at least in the Netherlands, it was sort of not there anymore. And the reason for that is that actually, this insect does really well in agricultural lands that have not been used for long. So they've been grown over with weeds or other things. And that's where they do really well. So in the first year, our fields look like this. So this is wheat. You see this nice green color. There's not a lot of weeds growing in there. It's just this the wheat, the crop that we actually grow. It was growing really well. We didn't find any of this species. We're also not specifically looking for it, but we didn't find it either. Then we had this one year, and actually, from our perspective, the crop failed because you can see it doesn't grow this nice green. You don't see these nice green leaves. You see that there's a lot of sort of flowers in between, kind of nice for some insects, but maybe not so nice for the farmers trying to grow it. But then all of a sudden, that year when the crop failed, we saw this species returning, and we actually found it quite often. And the story that I kind of want to give away with this is not necessarily, okay, we should just fail all our crops. That's not the story, but I kind of just want to show how versatile these insects could still be. So if you ever feel like everything's going to shit, we're losing all our insects, we're losing all our diversity, think of this story and think actually these insects are really versatile. And as long as we really put our shoulders underneath and under it and try to protect them and try to really make the habitats good for them again, they will come back, or at least some of them. So that's what I kind of wanted to show with this. I kind of like that as an example. So I think that was from my side. I see some anxious looks already. So I'll just then a quick wrap up. So the idea of my research, we want to sort of enforce these natural enemies. You see here one of the beetles eating a caterpillar, which might make the plants not look like this with all these caterpillars on them eating the leaves, but that we get nice, cool cabbages using strip cropping without pesticides. And then maybe we'll get these partridges back as well that are a bit endangered in the Netherlands. So that's a bit it. Thank you very much.
Wow, I see everybody so serious and maybe like amazed with the interesting new insect about the agriculture, more insect friendly. And then I'm curious about the question again. Maybe some people in here want to, raise the question.
Should I let go?
Yeah. What the different insects in my home and yeah.
That's a good question. So I think it's a dangerous question for an entomologist, right? I can't just say that you should just go out there and murder a bunch of insects. I think of course the home is a bit of a difficult situation, right? Because you can't just grow some plants there to get some other insects to go and clean up your insects. I think I wouldn't feel really sad if you swat that mosquito that's bugging you in your room, or if you throw out this silverfish that's bugging you. I wouldn't really be bothered too much about that. I think what I maybe want to give away is that what I like is that I really see this sort of change where it used to be that insects were just sort of creepy crawlers and people didn't really like them. And I do really see this change that people start noticing them and also sort of the beauty that they can have and the worth that they can have. So I think that's really nice. So I kind of like your question in that way as well, because I feel a little bit of guilt maybe coming from that way. And I think it's just really nice to hear that actually is an issue, because I think for some years ago, people would not even have thought twice about it, right? Like, it's just, I don't like this insect, done, right? That's just it. So that's nice. So, yeah.
Okay. After the different bees in the home and then in the runner, and then the next question.
Good question. Yeah. I kind of want to say, I don't like to answer. So I think that that's also partly just people talking about these things and showing why it is interesting. And I had a discussion about this the other time. I think probably some of the people in this audience are also scientists, or maybe some of the people here are scientists or working at university. And I think what makes it is that people are just enthusiastic about it, and people have been enthusiastic about insects for a long time. I mean, you already had like the people from the age of Darwin that were taking insects from all over the place and then collecting them. But I think it's not that they are necessarily the ones that are growing this interest, but it's people really enthusiastically talking about these things against people that actually from their nature or their background wouldn't really talk about these things. And that actually doesn't only hold for insects. I think it works for everyone's research field. It doesn't matter if you do something applied or something fundamental. I think in science, I see a lot of scientists that are super enthusiastic. I think if you want to prosper in science, you have to be enthusiastic, because if you just are in it for the money or for a nice job, I think you can better go somewhere else. There's probably better opportunities for you then. So you have to be enthusiastic. And I think as long as you can show this enthusiasm also to people that are not normally busy with this kind of stuff, I think that's how you can make this sort of change towards accepting something that is not yet accepted in that sense. Maybe it's a bit of a broader answer than you might want, because I don't really have a specific answer here. But
next question. There is any harder question? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Like cycling around Wageningen in the Binnenveld and just across the Rhine. And if I cycle there, then most of the fields they don't use any intercropping at all.
Mm-hmm.
While I've heard the buzz about intercropping for over a decade already, mm-hmm. What's holding back these farmers? Why doesn't it deal with that?
Yeah, so I think. So I'm also a bit new in it, right? So I might be wrong there, but what I get the impression of is that. That there has been research a lot on it, and the concept has been researched a lot, and we already know for I think a really long time. I think it was the founder of PNRC, De Witt, I think he was one of the first ones, right? But that's already like in the 80s or maybe the 70s or maybe longer ago already. So we know so long already about these interactions, but I think what held back is this. I think that it's just been that monocultures are easier. And I think there needs to be like practical solutions to these issues as well, and practical solutions for intercropping so that farmers can take them over. And I really believe that with this strip cropping, I think we really have sort of a little bit gold in our hands in that it is sort of this compromise between the two. And I'm not saying that this should be the end goal, but I do think that it's a nice compromise that can propel sort of farmers that are still growing monocultures or big crops to do at least strip cropping, which is a form of intercropping. And then maybe in the future, if we can continue working on this, we might be able to develop also techniques, robotics, things that can make the field even more diverse. So one thing that we are also trying in our experiments is pixel cropping. A colleague of mine is busy with that a lot. And the idea of pixel cropping is growing crops in, like, for example, 50 by 50 centimeters plots or just really tiny plots. And then every pixel has a different crop. And for now, that would be just impossible for farmers, right? You need to have like a really specific earning model. There's one farmer I know that actually does it. But yeah, he also has a bit of a different business model. But I do think that eventually we can go there as long as we also keep on developing towards that way. I think we've developed more complex things than these intercropping mechanisms. But that's a bit what I think.
Thank you for the question. And the next for the ladies.
Yeah. I was wondering, in your method of just seeing how many beetles or how many insects are there in the strips, do you really go to the strips and count the insects, or how do you measure the insects and your effects?
No, so oh yeah. So the question is sort of what methods we use to count insects in the field, right? That's I think the big question. Yeah, so it's a funny question. I think I like this one. So what's often done in insect research is that they use different ways of trapping. The difficulty is that especially if you look at insect species, it's often difficult to really save from camera footage or just by eye. So sadly, a lot of insects still have to be killed in order to see what sort of the abundance of certain species. What I do myself is I do a lot of pitfall trapping. The idea of pitfall trapping is that you make a hole in the ground, put a cup in it, and then put some water in there. And then the especially ground beetles, they just walk on the ground. They can't really climb that well. So then they fall into this trap, and that's the way that you can sort of identify them and count them. So that's the way that I use, but there's like a lot of different methods that are used for all different purposes. So I'm really focused at these ground beetles. That's why I use this thing. But I know also people that do pollinator research that use other methods again, also for trapping. So that's a bit how we do that.
Okay, interesting. And the next, anybody you want to ask again? Okay, if not, I can summarize some the question. The first talk about the different insect in our home, and then in others, and then the second about the world enthusiastic to research insect in the Dutch, and then the third question is about the challenging, maybe about the intercropping in here, and then the others, and also the end of the question is talk about the how to measure the insect or bees. So there is, I think, very very a mess presentation. Thank you very much for the time, and I think this time for the energizer again.
Thank you very much. Well, first of all, step one, turn the microphone on. Step two, thank presenter. So thank you very much for your presentation, and feel free to also join the audience. I must say that I really like that you ended positively, but on the other hand, I was also very curious about this gruesome content. I'm quite a horror lover myself, so that would also be very nice though. Especially on such a vivid screen, I would really have liked that. But then, the next and the final presenter of tonight, he might not be a student, but that is not a problem. I believe he's a teacher at work currently, are you? Yes, he is. And today, he will discuss one of the most current ongoing subjects in society, I believe. To vaccine or not to vaccine. I believe that after this presentation, you will know all the ins and outs about vaccines and about mRNA specifically. And therefore, I want to give the word up to Thijs.
Thanks very much. Well, first of all, I would like to make the point that it's really nice of the organizers to organize a meeting like this. In an era where science is just an opinion, it's about time that scientists explain to people that science is not just an opinion, but based on years and years of facts and research and hard arguing to build a hypothesis and to build a theory. And that is really important. So thanks a lot for organizing this meeting. When you asked me, I thought it might be cool. Well, I'm a plant cell biologist and I work at the university here, and most of our research is on plants, but I just happen to know, well, you might know that a plant cell and a human cell don't differ that much. They contain more or less the same contents. They follow the same procedures of life to build things. So I know a bit about these human cells as well. And I noticed lately there's something with a virus over the last year or something. And I noticed that lots of friends and family start asking me questions about this virus and about the vaccine. And I thought, well, maybe it's cool to tell you a bit about these vaccines that everybody's getting at the moment. I'm not sponsored by the pharmacy, by Moderna, by Pfizer. I don't have any opinion about vaccines. I'm just going to tell you the dry facts, see if you like it, see if you understand it. Sometimes it might get a bit complicated. But I'll try to bring it down to the bare essentials if I see hazy faces. Okay, so we'll start off quickly going through the immune system. I'm not going to bother you with all the details, but just refresh your memory a bit on the immune system. Then we'll dive into the cell, and I'll try to explain you what mRNA is and why it's so important. And then we'll move on to the vaccines, and I'll explain you how these vaccines manage to utilize mRNA to acquire immunity. Okay, so well, everybody is probably aware that we all should have an immune system. This immune system has two layers of defense. One layer of defense is the innate defense, which is your skin, but also some cells of your immune system that just attack anything that enters your body. The second layer of defense, that's called adaptive defense, that is a layer that is actually trained by all the intruders of your body. And the second layer of defense is actually important. If you once catch a disease, then you become resistant against this disease when it's when your body encounters it for a second time. So how does this work exactly? Well, I call this thing Corona or COVID-19, but this is just a bog standard virus. It's nothing special, this COVID-19 virus. All viruses have these spike proteins, and these spike proteins are really the nasty bits of the viruses that is used by the virus to enter a cell. And these spike proteins are being used by the immune system. It's a long story how the immune system uses these things. I'm not going to bother you about the details, but just remember, it uses these things that stick out from the virus to train B lymphocytes to develop weaponry against these viruses, but also to make memory cells against this virus. Now, we have this virus. What is different between vaccination and a virus or anything? It's not that much. The old school viruses that the old school vaccines that were developed, think about smallpox vaccines, they just consisted of something, an harmless sample of pus of a cow that had a similar virus, or disabled viruses that were injected into humans that made them resistant. So what you do, in fact, is you take part of the virus, this virus here, one of these spikes, and you get it into your body, and your body will develop immunity without encountering this virus. And that is really cool, because you don't get ill if you get vaccinated. So we have a couple of vaccines at the moment. We have four vaccines that everybody knows in the Netherlands at the moment. Two of them are called AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson. And the Dutch people call it Janssen because somehow there's a small company, sub-company in the Netherlands that works for Johnson & Johnson that's called Janssen. And yeah, we are Dutch, so we like to tell each other, well, we are great. So these two companies, they have developed innovative vaccines, which consist of a totally harmless virus that's in which they engineered by genetic modification one of these spikes from the coronavirus. And if you inject this virus, it is recognized by the immune system as a pathogen. Your immune system will develop defense against this virus, and you won't get ill. An even more innovative strategy is an mRNA-based virus, and the two names that should probably ring a bell is Pfizer and Moderna. So what you in fact do with both of these strategies is you modify the virus that you see over here into just a spike protein, and you use that spike protein to train your immune system. So you don't get ill, but you build up resistance. So the next time you encounter corona, likely somewhere this autumn, you're not going to get ill anymore, hopefully. Oh, this went terribly wrong here. Okay, now, an mRNA vaccine, how does that work? I need to bring up some gruesome details about cell biology before you can understand what an mRNA vaccine is doing. So here you see an image of a cell, a standard cell, stolen from a textbook that we use for first-year bachelor students. What you should remember here is that a eukaryotic cell, like our cells, consists of a lot of different compartments. The first important compartment is the nucleus. And in a previous presentation, DNA was very nicely introduced as a cooking book with recipes to build all kinds of different things. In our cells, in each of our cells, there is a nucleus, and each of these nuclei is the same set of DNA. This DNA is a cooking book for about 25,000 different proteins that we use to run our body. Now, if you're a cook, you know how bad it is if somebody messes up your cooking book. Sometimes they just steal a couple of pages or worse. So you want to be really careful with your cooking book. You store it, you hide it away in a safe place. And the safe place is the nucleus, right here in the middle of the cell. Now, around the nucleus is the cell, the remainder of the cell, the cytoplasm, that contains all kinds of different compartments that have different functions. And the cell is shielded from the environment by the plasma membrane that surrounds the cell. Now, in the nucleus, there is DNA, and DNA is your cooking book. And you need to be really careful with your cooking book. So what do you do if friends come around and ask you to borrow a recipe? Well, you make a copy or you make a picture of your cooking book, but you're not going to share the cooking book that is so important. And that is exactly what a cell does. A cell has the DNA in the nucleus and is careful about the DNA. When it needs the DNA for a recipe to build a protein, it uses messenger RNA. Messenger in Dutch means boodschapper. So it uses this RNA to transfer the information from the nucleus to the cytoplasm of the cell, and there, this messenger RNA is translated into a protein. So this step from DNA to messenger RNA happens in the nucleus and is referred to as transcription, and this step from mRNA to protein is referred to translation. So all the DNA is in the nucleus, the DNA encodes genes that are transcribed by mRNA, and the mRNA in the cytoplasm forms the proteins. Maybe I need to go back for 1 second. I put in this red cross to make a point, and I'm going to make the point now. And that is that the mRNA and the proteins cannot communicate, well, they cannot change, be modified into DNA. It's a one-way process. The DNA can turn into RNA, can be used to synthesize mRNA. The mRNA can be used to synthesize a protein, but mRNA or a protein cannot be used to synthesize DNA in a cell. Now, and this mRNA is really cool because it's very unstable. It's a messenger. And you don't want to have a messenger hanging around all the time and reminding you, you have to buy milk, you have to buy milk. After the messenger tells you the messenger can bugger off. So the mRNA is unstable. Okay, so here you see a graphical summary of what I just told you. Here's the DNA in the nucleus, nice and safe. And if a protein is needed, then the copier switches on and produces messenger RNA. The messenger RNA is transported out of the nucleus, this is the nuclear membrane, into the cytoplasm. And in the cytoplasm, there are these beautiful molecular machines that are called ribosomes, that bind to the messenger RNA, and can actually turn this messenger RNA into a protein. And this protein is growing while the messenger RNA is photocopied by this ribosomes. Now you know how a cell can make a protein, but we have a problem. This protein is produced in the cytoplasm, and if you want to activate the immune system, you need to get the protein outside the cell, where the immune system can see it. If you look at a cell can be considered as all kinds of different specialized compartments. The nucleus is the control room, and then there's all kinds of different transport and energy provision systems. But what you really need is you need to find the exit of the cell to bring this protein, the spike protein from this COVID virus, outside the cell. Now, that happens by a process that is called secretion. And the secretion follows a very fixed route. All proteins that are produced and are pumped outside the cell, think for example about insulin in your blood. Everybody who has diabetes or knows somebody who has diabetes knows how important this protein is. It's produced exactly the same way as all other proteins that are secreted into the extracellular space. They follow this very fixed route, and I outlined protein just to make the case by this red dot. It starts over here, and then it follows this complicated route, and then it ends up in a transport vesicle, and this vesicle fuses with the plasma membrane, and its contents are inserted into the extracellular space. So if you have a protein from a spike protein from the coronavirus, and you want it, you can find the mRNA of this spike protein from the coronavirus. This mRNA, if you can get it into the cell somehow, you can trick the cell into making these spike proteins. And now you need to get these spike proteins to the extracellular environment. So somehow you need to get these spike proteins into this endomembrane system. This endomembrane system, you can consider it as a conveyor belt that does all kinds of different modifications, and it produces your proteins, but also your mRNA that encodes the spike protein from COVID to the extracellular space. So if you want to use an mRNA vaccine, a question that you could ask is, how do you get the mRNA to produce a protein that is secreted by the cell? Now, this is a very elegant experiment that was done over 40 years ago already. What these researchers did is they took a messenger RNA from a protein that normally is localized to a compartment. This compartment is called ER, don't remember the name. This is a compartment, and it has a signal sequence. A regular protein that is localized in the cytoplasm of the cell doesn't have the signal sequence. If you take the signal sequence and you swap it and you put it on another protein, suddenly this other protein ends up in this compartment. And if you remove the signal sequence from a protein that normally ends up in a compartment, it ends up in the cytoplasm. So all you need to do to target a protein to a different location is add something to this protein or add something to the DNA, to the mRNA. And then your protein will automatically go to a different location. Now, how does that work? This is maybe too complicated to go into at the moment. But there's a whole machinery that translocates this mRNA and these molecular machines, these ribosomes, to the surface of one of these compartments. Okay, I hope you still bear with me. If not, time for a small summary. So the immune system triggers, uses proteins from intruders to trigger immunity. Now, if you have mRNA, mRNA has a function in translating the information from the DNA in the nucleus into proteins in the cytoplasm. And you have signal sequences on this mRNA to target a protein to different locations in or outside the cell. Okay, now we go into vaccines. And this is just a brief overview. I will be talking about this for 15 minutes now. This is just to show you how much research has been done in this mRNA vaccine field. mRNA was actually discovered in 1961. And since then, billions and billions of euros have been spent on research to actually
there were those people who had the idea, well, we could actually use this mRNA and do something, make a vaccine with this stuff. But then there were so many problems, and these squares all outline big breakthroughs that solve these problems. So it is incredible how much fundamental research has been invested to get this thing to work. Now, there's a lot of problems if you want to have a messenger RNA and use it as a vaccine. And one of these problems is, remember I told you the mRNA is very unstable. It breaks down very quickly. How do you store this stuff? If you inject it in your body, it's not inserted in a cell immediately. And if you don't do anything, it breaks down in a second. Now, this mRNA, if it's in your blood or in a muscle or wherever it is, cells don't take up mRNA. So you need to find a way to convince the cell to take up your messenger RNA that you inject. And then if you have a viral messenger RNA, cells don't like viruses. They have all kinds of defense systems to prevent translation of foreign DNA. So how do you overcome these things? And I'm not going to go into detail, but I'm just going to show you some summaries of research that has been done. And this is a very complicated image, but here you see a chunk of messenger RNA. And here you see all the different modifications that they came up with to stabilize this messenger RNA. The first thing they did is they added a cap to stabilize the front end of the messenger RNA, and they added a tail to prevent degradation from the minus end. They actually changed the font of the mRNA to make it more stable. And you can actually change some words in the mRNA to make it stable. You can even make mRNA to self-amplify. So there's all kinds of different things. And then when there was an additional problem, if you take RNA, RNA is really easy to produce. You just send an email to a company and they will send you back mRNA. That's it. And you pay a little bit, just a couple of euros. It's not expensive. But you need highly pure stuff. Firstly, because you can get side effects if it's not pure. And secondly, your cell doesn't want to transcribe this mRNA, to translate this mRNA into a protein. So you need highly purified stuff. And that took a lot of time to make mRNA that is that pure. Now we want to get mRNA that is vaccinated into our body, into the cells. There's one route, just like the exocytosis, the endomembrane system, that secretes proteins. There's a process that's called endocytosis that takes up things from the extracellular space into the cell. And here you can see this purple dot. Well, let's say it's an COVID-19 vaccine mRNA. And it ends up over here in these organelles that are degraded, and it can be recycled. But this mRNA, if it's being taken up, it never leaves these compartments. And to produce a protein, you need to get it into the white space, into the cytoplasm. So how do you do that? And the answer is trial and error. Still, researchers in this field don't know the answer. They don't know how they get the mRNA in, but they do know if you do certain tricks, then the mRNA does get through this membrane of the vesicle or the lysosome into the cell. And that is really cool. That is just throwing a lot of money and a lot of effort on your work and get the job done. And then we have an mRNA in the cell, and then the cell starts to produce a protein that is secreted. And here you can see a summary of the research in this field where they used all kinds of different tricks to stabilize the mRNA and to trick the cells into taking up this mRNA. I'm not going to go into detail, but this is just thousands and thousands of PhD student projects. Okay, now, there's some people who believe they are being tracked by the government if you're being vaccinated. I don't have an opinion about that, but I would just want to show you the dry facts. I did some quick Googling. The smallest radio frequency identification chip that is currently available, and it's brand new, is about 0.05 millimeters, so about 50 micrometers. And can it do anything? Yeah, it can store a 38-digit number. So in theory, it could be used to give everybody a personal number. And you can actually track somebody who has one of these chips inserted under ideal circumstances up to 200 meters. And yes, you can use a needle that is being used for vaccination to insert these chips. But then we run into a problem. If these chips, if they enter the bloodstream accidentally, they are much larger than the smallest blood vessels. And what you can get then is thrombosis, or worse, death. And we don't see that as a side effect when we do in mass vaccination. So it's, in my opinion, is highly unlikely that these vaccines contain microchips. Okay, now, I hope I convince you now that messenger RNA vaccines are the result of a lot of cool and fundamental and important research. It cost a lot of money. And these mRNA vaccines are really cool. You don't need to worry about a protein or a vector or a virus that is carrying this stuff. This mRNA can be made in a machine. So if there's a mutation in your virus, say the Delta variant that is arising now or something worse, that where our vaccinations don't work anymore, we just changed one letter in the mRNA and we start vaccinating again. Upscaling is not an issue. You just order this stuff and produce it. Once you know what to do, it's dirt cheap. mRNA vaccines, the cost price at the moment is $17, but that includes all the R&D that I talked about in this presentation. And you can scale it up and down as much as you wish for. And these 60 years of research, from 1961, the discovery of the mRNA, to 2021, when we started using mRNA vaccines, it was right at the right time. And what is the right time? I think there should be something happening now. It's time to have a beer outside in this nice summer weather. Thanks a lot, and I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you for the interesting presentation. And I see everybody's face already and safe and prepare the question. So who will be the first sharing the question? Anybody? Okay.
Yeah. When we talk about vaccines, different vaccines, you mentioned about Johnson & Johnson and AstraZeneca, and they all have a different efficacy, let's say, against the coronavirus. So what exactly caused this?
So the question is, what causes the different efficiencies of the different vaccines? I don't know the real data, but I can speculate about what causes these differences. Well, firstly, the type of spike protein that you're actually inserting, the total length of this spike protein, it can be a fragment or it can be multiple fragments. Then the efficiency of your vaccine in getting into cells. If it gets into 1,000 cells, you'll get a different response than when it gets into 100 cells. The vector is different. These vaccines also contain chemicals that are called adjuvants that determine how long the vaccine is going to be stable in your body. And different parts of different proteins have different immunoreactivity, which means that your immune system reacts more violently to one part of a protein than to another part of a protein. And that is just trial and error. So I guess that would explain most of the differences.
Okay. And then the next question? Okay. Come on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the question is, what causes different side effects of different vaccines? Yeah. Well, there's a lot of different side effects. So one thing that people call side effects is that you get a sore throat or a bit of a fever. And that is, in fact, not a side effect. That is your immune system being active. A fever is a way of your body to respond to an intruder, it means be on high alert. There's something going on there. So that's not really a side effect. That is just doing its work. And then there's these side effects. Well, of course, if you do an intramuscular injection, you get a sore arm for a couple of days. But there's all kind of different side effects that don't happen that frequently. You can have an allergic response to one of the ingredients of the vaccine. Commonly one of these adjuvants that make the vaccine more stable. I actually had a side effect. I had my first vaccination last week and all my lymph nodes were swollen at the left-hand side of my body. And it took over a week to go back to normal. And that's, apparently that is a side effect that happens in 1 in 100 people. And that is another sign that your body is aware that there's something going on. There's an intruder. And by swelling the lymph nodes, it tried to reduce that. And then you have the really bad side effects of the AstraZeneca and the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. That happens 1 in a million times. I don't know what that is causing, but I heard some gossip that it is caused by... they produce these vaccines in culture vessels that contain mostly insect cells to produce these viruses that they use to these harmless viruses. And apparently, if they don't clean it up sufficiently, then you can get these effects. And I'm not sure if that is true and how well they researched it, but that is a hypothesis that is being sung around to that side effect.
Okay, thank you for the question. Anybody want to ask? Okay, the ladies.
So the question is, AstraZeneca, does it use a plasmid? And how? Does it get it into a cell? But it doesn't use a plasmid. A plasmid is a circular piece of DNA. There's also vaccines, not against corona, but other vaccines, where they try to use DNA, which would also work. There is a very small risk that a chunk of DNA is inserted in your DNA in the nucleus. And the nice thing of mRNA is that there's no chance that is ever going to happen. These AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson vaccines use a virus, like a disarmed flu virus or a cold virus, that contain viral DNA. And in that viral DNA, there's a chunk of DNA from the spike protein from the coronavirus. So this virus is recognized by the body, by the immune system, and it recognizes the proteins that are exactly the same as the coronavirus's proteins on this virus. So it's not a DNA plasmid, but the DNA is in the viral DNA.
Okay, thank you. There is a question again? Okay.
Because we're now on about the AstraZeneca, and during your office explanation, you mentioned that if there would be a chip injected into your body, that you would get thrombosis. But with AstraZeneca, especially young females, there aren't enough cases. Yeah. So, me as a young female, could you explain?
Yeah.
I'm curious.
Now, this thrombosis is not caused by chips, but caused by a low blood platelet count and in combination with something else. I forgot what that was, but that does cause thrombosis. And this thrombosis, if there would be a chip, it would occur just as frequently in all vaccines and much more frequently than 1 in a million cases.
And how come that's in may are more common in females?
So why is it more common in females and in younger females particularly? I have no idea. I don't think they have an idea either.
Yeah.
If it's a contamination from the culture, the cell culture to produce the virus, I can only imagine that the immune system of younger females is working slightly better than the immune system of young males and much better than older females and males. So that might be an explanation.
Thank you. And I see somebody raise a hand. Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering, but you mentioned before that the so-called side effects where people get a bit out of fatigue or slightly fever or stuff, that it's basically your immune system responding to the vaccine. But there are also people who do not get any of these so-called kind of side effects. And is that because your body just responds differently to it, or how does some people do get that headache or
mm-hmm.
things, and some people are
completely fine. Yeah, good point. So the question is that why do some people get side effects like a fever and a sore throat that tell you that your immune system is working and others don't? I'm not an immunologist, so I don't really know the answer, but I could probably speculate about it a bit. And it's just like a regular cold. If a regular cold goes around in the winter, some people catch a cold all the time. Some people never catch a cold, and everybody catches different colds. And I guess that is exactly the variation that you're seeing when you do the vaccinations.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually one research saying that the major side effects, what's the name of it?
Thrombosis.
So that the thrombosis might be caused by something with the blood pellets or something. So I was wondering, could it then maybe not be that there's a lingering with menstruation? Because then there's also differences in like, certain blood. I am a biologist, I still don't know that much.
It's fine.
Well, the question is, would menstruation cause a more severe side effect with women? I never expected to answer a question about menstruation. I don't. I really don't know.
Okay. Anyone want to ask again?
I have a question for you, actually.
Yeah.
I've been wondering that since most of the scientists here have some disciplinary biology background, have a basic understanding of biology, yet even within the scientific community, I mean, like from a societal point of view, there have been quite a few people that have been against vaccines, even while being highly educated, highly motivated, highly informational seeking. My question to you, and I think I'll summarize that simple, would be how do you answer people that say, I've studied basic biology, this doesn't sound safe? What is the capsule image that you give to them?
Well, the question is, so why are even educated people sometimes opposed to vaccination? I come across a lot of uncertainty, and the stuff that I just presented, that is stuff that most of it is in first year cell biology lectures, but students tend to forget. So I don't think there's a huge population, even of the biology oriented students, who really grasps all the concepts, and neither do I. There's still some holes that I needed to look up to fully understand what's going on. And I don't have any idea why somebody who understands what's going on has a problem with this. We do the same thing with all our kids when they get all kind of different vaccines against much more lethal diseases. We have eradicated diseases like the plague and smallpox with the vaccines. So I don't know. I have these discussions once in a while, and I don't want to get into a fight. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion. We live in a free country, luckily, where we can decide that whether we want to make a certain choice. It's your own body. So if you do or don't want to have it, that's your own personal choice. And I can answer all questions that people have, but I cannot change their mind.
Can I ask a follow-up?
Yeah.
As an employee at Uber and as a person that deals with transformative dialogues that are happening, one thing that you hear very often from the Uber side right now is, are we activists enough within the political sphere of science? Are scientists positional or are they neutral? And to this I hear, even, I'm not saying that's what you're saying, but that's what I'm taking away, that's my takeaway decision, that get with the program, it works, we've done this for a while, and if not, leave. So what takeaway message would you give for that, for this transformation as you live in a free society, you do have the ability to do the disagree, but herd immunity doesn't mean that herd has to be herd.
Mm-hmm. So the question is, herd immunity obviously works with these vaccines. So what should we do as a scientist? Should we do something about encouraging people, convincing people to take a vaccination? My answer would be yes, if it would be a purely logical decision, but it's not a purely logical decision.
Yeah, okay. The next question.
And it's kind of difficult, it's not really easy to find people that are opposed to it, but most of the time they don't feel heard. They're described as pure stupid. So that's really a problem because most of the time they read a lot of stuff online and there are a lot of false information. There was a whole website on like why you shouldn't vaccinate. And we have references to science that was proven to be wrong. So that really means like, these are the facts. And that's why even in higher education, people might doubt. And one way to approach this is just to really listen to them why and really don't put them away. Probably you should do this. Really, often they are really more likely to say, I feel hurt. And,
we get a sociologist point of view that it's better to communicate, have open channel to somebody who's not convinced that he or she should be vaccinated, than trying to throw reasoning at them. That might well be. It's difficult, and it is a weird time, and especially exactly what you're saying. On the internet, you can find all kind of crazy stuff, and if people cannot discriminate the crazy stuff from the real stuff, then you're in trouble. Then you get exactly how I started my talk. Then science is just an opinion, and that is a very dangerous situation, in my opinion.
Windows, so whenever you need to get in at the right time as a scientist. That's really important.
Thank you for the explanation. And then I see somebody on the top raise the hand. Maybe have the question too?
Maybe.
Yeah?
I just wanted to respond because I'm not a communication scientist here at Happiness.
Yeah.
And it turns out that it's not about logical reasoning. People have emotions and insecurities and feelings, and a lot of times, like mostly better scientists, don't take that into account. So they are just like, okay, we have to throw information, then people will get it, and then it's fine. But it doesn't work like that.
Thank you. And then anybody has the question again? If not, maybe I can ask the question.
Yeah, sure.
Actually, yeah, I already prepared the question, and then I want to ask like there is the possibility to spread the mRNA vaccine in the world. However, we know that currently there are a lot of the country, not only in Dutch, but also maybe from my country in Indonesia, there are also some people already vaccinated, but the different vaccine, not mRNA vaccine. So what the effect if we mix after we already get the vaccine with the Sinovac, and then what the vaccine will we mix with the mRNA vaccine?
That's a nice question. And people have started, researchers have started experimenting with that, actually. So remember that each vaccine may have a different piece of the spike protein. And what you do, these Pfizer and Moderna vaccines and AstraZeneca vaccines, you get a booster after a couple of weeks. And this booster is generally really important to trigger your immune system to respond. So if it's a substance that is just barely recognized by your body as pathogenic, then doing this booster helps a lot. And if you, the hypothesis is in this research that I do in Great Britain now, is if you use two partially overlapping fragments of this coronavirus, can you do a more extreme booster? And the answer seems to be yes.
Yeah, okay.
So that does make sense. Yeah. to get as much vaccines in your arm as you can.
I hope this not making people scary. Yeah. Okay. Some people asked the question.
Actually, it's maybe a bit of a practical one. I got this one from my sister, actually. Mm-hmm. So, and she was wondering, because she was getting the vaccine, but then had to get tested for corona for an event.
Mm-hmm.
So if she gets the vaccine and they get tested, would they find, like, give her a positive test because she just got the vaccine?
Mm-hmm.
Or would that not happen?
So the question is, if you get vaccinated, would you get a positive corona test? And the answer is, no, unless you take a blood test. You have the antigen test, and the antigen test, the self-tests that we use in the classrooms, they would show up as positive if they are targeted against the same part of the virus, which I don't know, but that's a nice try if you so a nice experiment at home. If you have been vaccinated, just check what these self-tests do. I have them at home, and I'm going to try this evening, actually. the PCR test, which tests for the presence of the viral RNA or DNA in your nose or in your mouth, that's not where the proteins would go when you use a vaccine. So you should have a negative test in that case.
Okay, and then maybe we can conclude this discussion. Like when I hear there are a lot of the interesting new insects from the interactive discussion, like the first people doubt about the side effect of the mRNA vaccine and also the other vaccines, and also about the menstruation of women, and also herd immunity, and also why people educated not really want to get the vaccine, and others interesting question from the interesting participant and also interesting presenter in here. So maybe I can continue for my colleagues to conclusion.
Okay. Nicely done. And thank you to Thijs, especially. Does it work? Okay, it works. Well, this has been an interesting night, if I can say. If I can say, I saw like a small trend of food. We started, of course, with food provision, no explanation needed. Then we went to cow stables, but this was compared to cakes and to brownies. Then we went to insects, which nowadays we can eat them too. And then the last subject was about RNA, but we were going to combine it with cooking books. So, after all, this could have been a food night, but that's also very nice to know. And next to food, it was super diverse. I also did not expect that we would discuss menstruation this night, but here we were. Being open about it all, that's no problem. And I really liked that we all had a positive ending and that there's beer on the last slide. I think we're all longing for that. So then, from my end, I want to ask you all, if you registered, you will receive an evaluation form. Since most of you are aware, this is for our ACT project, so your evaluation is kind of valuable. No pressure, but if you would be able to do it before tomorrow noon, we can still use it for a deadline. I understand that for some this might be hard, but for the ones who are able, thank you in advance. But you will see it later in your email box. Yeah, next to that, I'm slowly scanning my colleagues if they wish to add something. I don't think they want to add anything, except for Robin. Okay. Tessa, were you able to register in advance? Okay, so I think it's only Tessa, from which I know. I think everyone else is registered, right? I don't see it. Yes. That will be taken care of. You are not registered? No problem. Two people to register. All is safe. All will work out. Then, if there's nothing else left to say, I want to thank you all for being here to help us with our ACT project. And thank you all for attending online. This feels so fancy to look at the camera. And thank you mostly to our presenters for providing content for this night. And then I would actually also like to thank my team members for making all of this possible. So, Ferna, for the funny in-between Q&A talks, please give it up for Ferna. Then all the way up in the back over there is Anne, who did the coordination. You might not have heard her very much, but she was coordinating the stuff. So also, applause to her. Then a girl in the middle called Amber Wu coordinated the online aspect of this event. Also an applause to her. then our team manager will open this evening and will also just keeps us a bit sane during this ACT times, which is a lot of stress, as most of you are aware of. Ilse? Then I also want to give a short moment to someone who unfortunately already left. Abigail was as well here. She's from Ghana, but her home was flooded. So that is a super sad situation, but I still believe that she deserves some kind of attention. Hence why I wanted to mention her as well, since she also hugely collaborated for this event. So even though she's not here, also a thanks up for her. And if you don't mind, I'm not going to thank myself because that feels so weird. It's like... So yeah, that's it. Thank you all. If you want to, you can have like a drink before you leave. Don't forget your mask when you leave. And Thijs and Tessa, please register. And that's all. Thank you all.